postponed to October 3rd for re-advertising. And that was somebody knows.
What number?
Six and seven on the public hearing.
Six and seven on the public hearing.
Okay, that actually, I don't know.
Sorry.
It had changed. So we're postponing both six and seven to October 1st. Correct?
That was a formal motion.
A second. All in favor, can you please vote? Motion carries four zero. That's one of my changes in our district line this time. District one is now represented. Any other changes to the agenda?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I would ask that the board remove consent agenda item 4H regarding the approval of the proposed recreation center membership fees and move that to the next available public hearing. Perhaps a public input.
Joey, what date are? October 3rd.
October 3rd.
Move October 3rd, please.
Second.
Ask the staff advertise that on appropriately.
Have a motion second to remove item H on consent agenda, 4H to October 3rd for public hearing. Please vote. Motion carries four zero.
Mr. Chairman, I would ask that, is there someone here from Brentwood Estates Homeowners Association?
Yes, sir.
Are you working with the Long Lake Association?
We have been.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what, we'll have a public hearing this evening, and that we may postpone the decision.
Okay.
All right, thank you. We move forward with that.
Thank you, sir. Any other changes, additions? Counselor, do you have anything?
Mr. Chairman, thank you, I do not.
Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
Second.
Have a motion second, please vote. Motion carries four zero. Under announcements and reports, we have a couple tonight. I will do one, and Commissioner Mills has another. But I would like to announce that coming regional readiness center, the headquarters of the 560 Battlefield Surveillance Brigade, is located at 100 Aquatic Circle, Cumming, Georgia. We'll have the grand opening September 14, 2013. It's the drill hall dedication and the ribbon cutting for the ceremony. All public are invited, so if anyone wants to attend to see the new National Guard Armory, it's what this is, located off Cooper Mill Road, Aquatic Circle. They ask in September 14th. Starting at 9 o'clock in the morning. Thank you. Ms. Mills, you have a proclamation?
I do. Would Ms. Tatum, Lisa Tatum, and your son please come down? Thank you for coming and thank you for bringing this to our attention. What's your name? I'm sorry. Kevin?
McKever.
McKever. Thank you, McKever, for coming. This is a proclamation by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia. Whereas mitochondria are located in every cell of the human body and contain genetic material, and whereas mitochondria are responsible for processing oxygen and converting substances from the foods we eat into energy for essential cell functions, and whereas mitochondria disease, the body's inability to turn food into the energy to sustain life, can cause a wide range of health issues, including seizures, low blood counts, blindness, deafness, dementia, heart failure, and progressive muscle weakness, and whereas symptoms of mitochondrial disease can cause symptoms at any age and compromise affected individuals' lives significantly, and whereas while no cure exists, early diagnosis and treatment can help reduce symptoms and delay or prevent the progression of the disease, and whereas through public awareness, Forsyth County seeks to minimize the devastating effects of the illness among all Forsyth County citizens. Now therefore, the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaims September 15th through 21st, 2013, as the Mitochondrial Disease Awareness Week. In testimony thereof, we have assigned and sealed the fix of Forsyth County, State of Georgia, and the signatures of the member governing body thereof this fifth day of September 2013. If you will, thank you for bringing this to our attention. And we'll come down for a picture, and then we'll, as soon as Commissioner Levant gets here, we'll get his signature and get these to you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Public comment. Jody, will you read the rules?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts of applause or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. We have 3 public comment speakers signed up this evening. Our first speaker is Casey Stevens.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. Ms. Mills. Before I get to what I want to talk about, I do want to thank y'all for your service. It's a very thankless job and getting pressure from both sides, and I appreciate you. I want to talk to you this evening about the Nichols Road zoning issue. I know it's not on the agenda for this evening, it's coming up in a couple of weeks. I've talked to a lot of folks about this, and when I look at this issue, couple things occur to me. One is that the overwhelming majority of the folks that live in the area where this rezoning is to take place are strongly opposed to any type of higher density zoning in that area. The other thing that occurs to me is if this parcel is rezoned to RES4, there's going to be an awful lot of ticked off people up in that area. So I ask myself, why is this such a hot button issue with people? And why are so many people engaged and so opposed to higher density zoning than what currently exists in the area? And it's obvious to me that the reason is it goes to the very heart of why we live in Forsyth County in the first place. My wife and I moved here 18 years ago. We looked in Gwinnett, we looked in North Fulton, we looked in town, we looked in a lot of areas. And what we liked about Forsyth County was the fact that the way the land had developed over the years, you know, we loved the rolling hills, We love the larger lot sizes, and the way the land was developed over time was in a manner that preserved the natural beauty of the landscape, but also allowed for growth. The first piece of property we had was a starter home on a half acre of land. Our current home has a nice little creek that goes through it, and it's right off of Nichols Road. So we decided it was a place that we wanted to call home and raise our kids. And I suspect that a lot of people that live in our area were motivated by that very same reason, okay? You can look at Gwinnett County right across the river, all right, to see the difference between Forsyth County and Gwinnett County. And I don't think we want to be anything like Gwinnett County. There's a reason we live in Forsyth County. Because of the way the development has taken place through the years, also, Forsyth County has attracted a lot of very successful people that are community driven. You have a lot of community leaders, a lot of people that are very involved in the schools. We have one of the best school systems in the state, and the last time I checked, it's one of the wealthiest counties in the entire country, all right? And that didn't happen by accident. It's because of the people that live here, okay, that drive this community and drive the success of the schools, all right? I can tell you that people did not move to Forsyth County because they wanted higher density.
Mr. Can I just have this 30 seconds?
You have 30 seconds.
Sorry.
No problem. We all recognize that there is going to be development, okay? We understand that. We just ask that it be done in a socially responsible manner and in a manner that's consistent with the zoning that currently exists in that area. In a couple of years, the owner of that property, the realtor, the developer, they're all going to be gone. The people that are going to have to live with the consequences are the people that live there, okay? People that support this community are going to have to live with those consequences. I just ask that you take that into consideration.
Our next speaker is Steve Benefield.
Hello, my name is Steve Benefield, and I live in the Lambert School District. It's the absence of the commissioner of events, but I'm not here to talk about the traffic and coming. At the next commission meeting, there will be a hearing on ZA 3625, a request to rezone 35.14 acres from Ag 1 agriculture to single family residential res 4, right across the street from Lambert High School. Although I oppose this rezoning, it is the broader issue of higher density housing I would like to address at this time. The current trend in Forsyth County is to rezone available property and build higher densities than the infrastructure and schools can handle. We must change direction now before it is too late. The residents in South Forsyth feel that the quality of life we now enjoy is under developmental attack. It is ironic that the things that make this area a great place to live also make it a target for development. Many longtime residents of Metro Atlanta have seen the repeating pattern. They move from DeKalb County to Gwinnett County, from Gwinnett to Forsyth. Unchecked development will be detrimental to every resident in this county. The decisions we make today will have an effect on our community for many years to come. We must make the correct zoning decisions now so that future decision makers will follow our lead. Bear in mind that our current position in this community is only temporary. New commissioners will be elected, HOAs will change offices, lawyers will change practices, and builders will retire. Will the mark we leave on the community be a positive one? As you have already seen, there is a current groundswell of opposition against this type of rezoning. This groundswell is quickly becoming an organized effort. There will be tremendous pressure put on the Board of Commissioners to deny higher density housing and to change land use map altogether. The Commission has a great opportunity to demonstrate that they're not just elected officials, but stewards of the community. Years from now, when we speak of past commissioners, my hope is that we will be thankful for your service, not regretful. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. General. I would like to make one announcement, Jody. Commissioner Beth arrived at 5:17.
Our next speaker is Richard Butler.
Good
name is Richard Butler, I'm the Long Lake HOA and the Off 141. I represent 542 homes, and we're here to oppose modification number AZ130021, the removal of the 35-foot buffer. Our residents are concerned that removal of that buffer is going to take away a visual, sound, and stormwater mitigation buffer area that they had when they moved in the neighborhood. We're afraid it's a bad precedent for the county and for our neighborhood. Our residents are concerned that other neighborhoods are going to request for buffers to be relaxed as well, and then we'll go down that road. We have a lake that's downstream of this buffalo area that's already had to be dredged, and if we start removing the buffer, we could very well incur significant costs again. We don't want to do that. And this is an issue that was disclosed to all parties when they bought lots in our neighborhood and in Brentwood Estates, that there was this 35-foot buffer that's already been decided, and we don't want to renegotiate that. We've got 222 signed petitions by residents opposing this motion. We got that collected in a couple of days. I did not speak to anybody on my board or in our neighborhood that was in favor of this. They were all against it. So appreciate your consideration and supporting prior decisions.
Thanks, sir.
Just a clarification.
Yes.
You were speaking in opposition to ZA2774.
The removal of 35-foot buffer added at 130021.
Public hearing item 4.
I see. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Thank you.
That was our final speaker, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Joe. I think everyone can not speak to that. Adoption of the minutes. Is there a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meeting and the executive session of August 15th, 2013?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Please vote. That motion carries 5-0. Is there a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and the executive session of August 27th, 2013?
Second.
Motion to second to adopt. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Is there a motion to adopt the consent agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second. Motion to second to adopt the consent agenda. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Move on to item 8. Public hearings. Item 1A is request for approval of alcohol license as follows. 1A.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Case number AL130608, Young and Wang Incorporated, DBA China Garden, Commission District 1. This is a request for approval of an alcohol license for Young and Wang Incorporated, DBA China Garden. Name licensee is Wee Man Yong for an application to sell malt beverages and wine for consumption on the premises at their place of business located at 2647 Freedom Parkway, Suite 170. All of the information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Public hearing. Is anyone here this afternoon speaking in favor of Young and Wayne? Anyone here speaking in opposition? Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Have a motion second to close. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. That's District 1, my district. I make a motion that we approve the request for an alcohol license to sell malt beverages and wine for consumption on the premises for Young and Wayne Incorporated, doing business as China Garden. The name licensee is Wee Ham Young AL130608. Have a motion and second, please vote. Motion carries five zero. Item one B.
AL130609, Green China Incorporated, DBA Green China Cafe, Commission District 2. This is a request for approval of an alcohol license for Green China Incorporated, DBA Green China Cafe. Named licensee is Yong Shen Deng for an application to sell malt beverages and wine for consumption on the premises at their place of business, located at 3105 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 107. All of the information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
Have a motion and second to open. Please vote. Motion carries five zero. Is anyone here speaking in favor of Green China tonight? Anyone speak in opposition? Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Have a motion and second to close. Please vote. That motion carries five zero. Mr. Town, will that your district?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's my understanding the application is in order. Therefore, I would move to approve the application for Green China Inc., doing business as Green China Cafe. Name licensee is Yong Sheng Deng. The application is to sell malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on premise, AL130609.
Second. Have a motion and a second for approval. Please vote. The motion carries five. On item 1C.
Case number AL130610, Rosatis Pizza and Pub of Cumming, Georgia, Inc., doing business as Rosatis Pizza and Pub, Commission District 2. This is a request for approval of an alcohol license for Rosatis Pizza and Pub of Cumming, Georgia, Inc., doing business as Rosatis Pizza and Pub. Name licensee is Matthew Smith, for an application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on the premises at their place of business, located at 415 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 200. All of the information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to open the hearing. Please vote. Motion carries five zero. Does anyone here this evening speak in favor of Rosito's Pizza? Anyone here speak in opposition? Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Have a motion and a second to close. Please vote. Motion carries five zero. Commission District 2, Commissioner Tam.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it's my understanding the application is in order. Therefore, I would ask that we approve the application for Rosatis Pizza and Pub of Cumming, Georgia, Inc., doing business as Rosatis Pizza and Pub. Name licensee is Matthew Smith. The application is to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on the premises, AL130610.
Second. Have a motion and a second for approval. Please vote. Motion carries five. Item 1D.
Application AL130611, Cafe Carib, LLC, doing business as Cafe Carib, Commission District 2. This is a request for approval of an alcohol license for Cafe Carib, LLC, doing business as Cafe Carib. Named licensee is Jesus Trito, for an application to sell malt beverages and wine for consumption on the premises at their place of business, located at 3455 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 213. All the information contained in this application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I hear a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Please vote. Motion carries five. Does anyone here this evening speak in Cafe Carib? Anyone speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Motion second to close, please vote. Motion carries five to zero. Commissioner Tatum, you have another?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's my understanding the application is in order. Therefore, I would move to approve the application for Cafe Ride LLC, doing business as Cafe Ride, and licensee is Jesus Trito. The application is to sell malt beverages, beer and wine for consumption on the premise, AL 130611.
Second. Have a motion second for approval, please vote. That motion carries five to zero. On to item two, the first reading of proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Fire Safety Prevention Ordinance. County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you very much. This evening, we have a first reading of a proposed modification to Forsyth County Ordinance 79, which is the Fire Safety and Prevention Ordinance. Because this is the first public hearing, there can be no opportunity to adopt this evening. We'll be up for a second public hearing in October. Officer Head from the Forsyth County Fire Department is actually here to make the presentation, and Mr. Chairman, I would ask that Officer Head be given the floor to make that presentation.
Thank you, Captain. Chair, entertain a motion to open the public hearing. Have a motion second. Please vote. Motion carries five to zero. Is anyone here this evening like to speak in favor? Proposed amendments?
Yeah, Officer Head, I think this may be your cue.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Board. We're here tonight to discuss the proposed amendments to Ordinance 79E. And we'll prepare a brief PowerPoint for you. After which, if you have any clarification that needs to be done, we'll be happy to address that. As we go along, we'll be referring to some state statute. Some clarification. Georgia Title 25, which is the regulation of fire and other hazards to persons and property, that's where most of this comes from. If you see 25.24, this is what authorizes the Georgia Safety Fire Commissioner to adopt rules and regulations as deemed necessary to promote the enforcement of the state minimum fire standards. These rules and regulations have the force and effect of law statewide. Rule 123.3 specifies those codes and standards that will be recognized as a state minimum fire safety standard. Part of that being the International Fire Code in conjunction with the state amendments. And that's what's recognized in the state minimum standard fire code. And it's important to point out that the requirements of the standard are not applicable to one and two family dwellings. 25.12.2 mandates the adoption of the state minimum fire safety standards by government authorities in counties with populations in excess of 100,000. 25.34 authorizes the county government authority to enact ordinances deemed necessary to perform fire safety inspections and related activities. As you know, Ordinance 79E was last modified in October of 2005. In 2007, the state went to a different standard. They went to the International Fire Code, which was published in 2006. We're here to urge you to adopt that. We were hoping that it would be an automatic adoption. Our verbiage in our current ordinance, excuse me, did not allow for an automatic adoption. Some of the highlighted changes of the amendments that were proposed is in Section 3, the adoption of the state minimum fire safety standards. And the verbiage there is to modify and reflect current state minimum fire safety standards adoption by reference of OCGA 8-2-200, which provides alternative methods of compliance for existing buildings. Moving on to Section 5, the Bureau of Fire Prevention, add verbiage that is consistent with the state minimum fire safety standard to clarify that the fire marshal and the deputy fire marshal as the official officers authorized to order evacuation of unsafe buildings. And this verbiage is added to clarify the local officials that have the authorization to order evacuations. Section 8, fire hydrants. Specify fire flow requirements for hydrants in commercial and industrial buildings and high density residential. Also increases the maximum distance from hydrant to fire department connection from 50 to 100 feet and provides a standard of testing for fire hydrants on private systems. And these are recommended to allow flexibility for placement of hydrants without compromising fire suppression hydrants. The next one is section 9, electrical wires. And it's to modify to require exterior means of electrical disconnect on newly permitted structures. And the purpose of that is to allow rapid disconnect of the electrical service of the building in an emergency or a fire. We've got a couple of pictures here. Section 10, the inspection of buildings and structures. There's no real change to the body of this particular section. We simply relocated it out of section 10 to section 12. Section 11, the collection of fees and issues of permits and approvals. It adds additional structures and components to the permitting system and fees, and it includes grease hood systems and paint booths, which have suppression systems in them, and we're already doing the permitting process for those, the inspection process. It simply allows us to collect the fee for that. It also gives the ability to review them prior to the construction or installation and help evaluate and cut off some of the problems associated with those prior to construction. It adds storage tanks for hazardous materials under 660 gallons. The state actually takes over from 660 gallons on it. And it requires a plan for the Rule 123.3 of the Georgia Fire Safety Commission. Tents and membrane structures. Require the approval permitting for tents and membrane structures having an area in excess of 200 square feet and canopies in excess of 400 square feet. And there are several exceptions to the rule. Tents that are used exclusively for recreational camping purposes, fabric canopies that are open on all sides, which comply with the following. Individual canopies having a maximum size of 700 square feet, or the next one is the aggregate total of multiple canopies placed side by side with a fire break of 12 feet, not exceeding 1,200 square feet. Correction, 700 square feet. And it allocates a minimum clearance of 12 feet to all other structures. This is not something that is new or exclusive to Forsyth County. We have a list here of other jurisdictions that actually have this in place already. And if you'll notice the top one, that's the city of Cumming. They already have this in place. Sandy Springs, Cobb County, the city of Woodstock, Gwinnett, McCabe, all of your metropolitan areas have this in place. Another one is the explosive fireworks. This is permitting that authorized under 120-3-10. It allocates a proposed permit fee, that is the permit that is already required and is handled through ourselves and the probate court. It simply allows us to collect that fee, and that is related to professional fireworks displays. Also attached is a supplemental ordinance pertaining to raw wood waste processing and recycling storage and operations. Comes out of the state minimum fire prevention code. It will require a permit for mulching and recycling operations and establishes some operating guidelines. Section 12, plans and drawings, is modified to specify requirements for construction. We just simply cleaned up some of the verbiage that was there. Section 16, response to malfunctioning and false alarms, is modified for clarification for the part of it. Section 19, outdoor burning. It asks bonfire to permit outdoor burning. And this was due in part by many calls from civic groups and schools and churches that wanted to have bonfires, but simply didn't have a permitting process for those. It adds aerial luminary to prohibited activities. Those are already covered under state law, but it gives us a way of dealing with them locally. And adds some requirements for outdoor fire pits, chimneys, etc. And this is something that we get many complaints and calls and inquiries on, and specifies what type of devices it could be used and isolates the equipment from combustible products. And it's referenced to make that into the Unified Development Code to ensure that the local regulations are set up to comply. Section 20 is fire lanes. It added the definition of a fire lane, added reference to the fire lane specifications document. Section 21 pertains to fire department access roadways. It adds a minimum gate width. We currently don't have a current standard. And this is to ensure that we have proper access for the fire equipment, making ingress and egress to the buildings. It adds a key box requirement for new permitted buildings, structural properties. Again, that's a recommendation for immediate access to firefighting and other emergencies. Section 22, attached multifamily dwellings. It removes the 2-hour fire barrier requirement in lieu of an automatic sprinkler requirement for attached multifamily dwellings. However, that would exclude townhomes. This time, I'd like to ask staff, Mr. Baker, to approach the podium, and he will address any clarification or points of concern. Board may have.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Steve Baker with the Fire Marshal's Office.
Thanks, Steve.
Thank you, Tim. Yes, sir, we're right here.
First of all, somewhere in the beginning of the presentation, I think you said at least part of it does not apply to single and dual family homes. Which part doesn't apply to them? Part about tents or any of it?
Partially about the tents. The state minimum standard doesn't apply at all to one or two family dwellings. So to address the tents, if someone was having a wedding or birthday party in their backyard, that's not something that we would address. The tent requirement is for mercantile type occupancies that set up in parking lots and assembly type occupancies that have large tents.
Like in a wedding, sometimes small wedding?
It would not apply to a wedding held at a personal home, but if it were held at an event center, it would actually apply to that.
For the slide you had, it says something about 666 gallons of storage. My question is, gallons of what?
Hazardous materials.
Does that define that?
There's actually a statute that
defines it. All right. And then the recycling, you know, we have some recycling centers sometimes in schools. We've got a recycling center in the south of the county. Is there some special thing or permit they're going to have to get before having done that?
No, sir. This applies strictly to wood mulch processing and recycling center.
I had some questions, and our county attorney has not been able to get the answers yet, which I know we're not adopting tonight, but some of those were my concern with the automatic adoption. I understand why you guys would like to have that. I know you'd love to come before us and see us, but you would like to have that. I, just as an elected official, I have an issue with anything that has an automatic adoption that we wouldn't have a say in or get to hear from the public on. Also, I had a question that I know when y'all presented at the work session that you said that this was a matter of liability for the county, that it needed to be adopted. And my question to Ken was, do we have to adopt it all, or can we make changes to specific things within it? And if we do make changes, does that create a liability for the county? And then on your access roadways, I know it was just a brief, I've got a road right now that I'm dealing with in North Forsyth that is, it's a bankrupt now piece of property that it's I mean, it's not a real subdivision. It's, they, we can't right now get a fire truck into it. And I know that you're probably, that verbiage maybe is for subdivisions being built that would make the roadways, but how does that affect roadways that are presently not being kept up by the property owners? It's not a county road. We don't have the right of way, but we can't even get a fire truck in there if we wanted to right now.
We can't access it due to the gate is secure.
No, the road is in such terrible condition.
Road is partially washed out. It's big holes in it.
I mean, does this verbiage apply to that? There's 32 trailers.
The intent of this proposal here is just to allow access to structures that are in place or occupied. We just don't have, we don't currently have anything to look to give us guidance on, gate width.
This
is just gates.
Gates and subdivision have probably drives.
Yes, sir.
Have access to them at a minimum gate width.
Yes, sir.
That's what this is.
Okay. All right, and there was, I didn't hear you talk about tonight, but I do remember in the work session, there was something in there about charging back that it gave you the ability. I didn't hear you mention that tonight. And I think the mulch thing was where it came from. But I want that to be a little clearer. Who, what, if you go out and a fire, you deem a fire is negligent, does that give you the ability to charge any homeowner?
No, ma'am. What that does is, it gives the court system, the local court system, a tool for recuperating those expenses. What would have to take place was if we went out and we thought that there was a gross negligence or a blatant violation of the code, it would be a citation issue. When that goes to court, it gives the local court the ability to recoup those costs. It's not like we would send them a bill, but it's just a tool that they would use to recoup those expenses.
Okay.
But that would not apply to 1 and 2 family homes?
That particular section, sir, it would be part of the county ordinance, and it would be applicable, but that's not the intent of it. The intent of it is for larger scale stuff, larger scale instances.
Could we make it?
They pay tax dollars for us to respond to their homes.
Right. That's what my thinking was, and the verbiage worried me because it did not make it. It left it wide open for interpretation. It might not be the intent, but the person that comes after you might interpret it differently, and all of a sudden the taxpayer that's paying for their fire service could be slapped with a bill. I mean, can we tighten that language up that it's just?
We could certainly confer with council and get that cleaned up for you.
All right, one more question on tents. My daughter, my granddaughter's birthday party's coming up, and I have a 20 by 40 tent that's going to be at Dennis Bottom's backyard. Would that, if this had been adopted, would that require me to come in and get a permit and then you come out and inspect it?
No, ma'am.
Now, the Dennis Bottoms could be considered an event facility.
Because he has.
If it's an event, if it's a public assembly, a business, it would be required.
So he we would consider him an event facility.
I don't like that. I don't like that at all. That's the question.
That's straight out of the state statute.
But that goes back to my question. Are we required to go? I mean, I've talked to several commissioners from other counties, but my fear is there, most of them are in counties like Dawson County that's under the 100,000 threshold, and they gutted a lot of this. They did not force some of this on their citizens. And I just want to know what parts, if we're allowed to not do some of this. I mean, we live in a Republican county that's supposed to be less government, and then we sit and we adopt things that create, the next thing you know, you're going to want us to hire more inspectors, more this, and all of a sudden we've grown government.
We would like for you to do that anyway.
I know you would. And I just want us to be very cautious before we jump into it.
Well, I think they did a good job of putting it in. The statute says what it says, and I know there is a triggering device with respect to the last decennial census that requires us to absolutely adopt the state minimum fire regulations. I get that. I think your question is more nuanced than that. Your question
question is, are we doing anything more than what is legally required by the state statute? And that's the answer, that's the question that I'm not able to articulate an answer for you for purposes of tonight.
Thank you.
Any other questions by the board? Thank you, Steve. Let's see if the public has some questions for us from the manager.
Thank you.
This time, we'll turn it over to the public. Are there any questions from the public or comments from the public? Yes, sir. Move back to Kirk.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I'm Kirk Winterstein. I live in Forsyth County. I speak only for myself. I do speak in support of what is being proposed, but I too have a very, what I believe, very legitimate concern about what happens when somebody who's normally a very responsible person, their house being burned down, and then they're given a citation for the cost of bringing out the fire trucks. And sometimes people are very responsible, but they make a mistake. And I don't think every citizen should be given a citation when the fire department responds. And I don't know who's going to make that judgment of who's going to get a citation and who isn't going to get a citation. So I, too, have a very strong concern about writing a citation or time to please the fire department comes down. And I don't know who's going to make that judgment call, and I'm concerned about favoritism. But I am concerned about the same people. The fire truck is constantly showing up at their location. Also, I'm sympathetic to that. I do support this because I think overall this is going to help our fire department. I think our fire department does do a good job, and I would look forward to us helping them out. Mr. Chairman, Mr. Commissioners, Madam Commissioner.
Chief Head, one question. Any fire now, we have to deem where it's arsenal or accident.
We try to, yes, sir.
Yeah, I mean, you could issue a citation if it was deemed to be arson.
Well, that's not the intent. If it were arson, we would be taking it through different avenues.
Yes.
This would pertain strictly to violations of the ordinance, not necessarily state.
We can redefine that, maybe.
Yes, sir.
Anyone else like to make any comments?
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm David Saxton, and I represent Tisdale, Georgia. And what I'm understanding here is that you know how the rain's been on some. If Pando is having a company party Saturday, and they decide Friday's going to rain because that's the way it's been happening, and they've got 100 people for their company party that they're going to have caterers, everybody doing all their decorations, but they don't need a tent Saturday morning for 100 people, then they call us and we can't do it, so they have to cancel their party because it's more than 700 square feet.
But that's a good question. But that's not an event facility, is it?
It's a business.
It's a business.
Okay, so
yeah, it's a business. So, you know, it's not a resident, yet we say, well, we can't do that because we got to file for a permit, we got to pay $100, we got to wait whatever period it is to have this inspected. Because we can blend with tents is here too, and I think people agree with the stuff I'm saying. Half of our business is based on quickness because of rain. So what we're saying is it's going to be pouring rain, but we're not going to be able to put up a tent because there might be a fire. It's raining an inch an hour, but there might be a fire under this tent because it's I mean, that the point making is that's what our business is based on. And, you know, I appreciate the job you guys are doing, and I know that I feel real comfortable with the board we got now because I feel like y'all are able to agree to disagree, and I like that in government. And I feel y'all are leading us in the direction that less government is better, and I feel like this is overkill. Basically, it'll put me and William partially out of business because of this. I know they do this in Johns Creek and places like that, and the businesses can't even have a tent sell out in their yard. They can't do nothing, you know, they can't have nothing because the government's not trying to help them survive. They're trying to close them down. And I know that's not what y'all want. We carry complete liability, we carry millions of dollars of liability insurance on their companies. I've got the California flame resistance forms for every piece of vinyl that I own right here, and that's the strictest standards in this company, the flame resistance. And I've got a certified copy of every one of them, and I know William does too. And I feel like this is totally unnecessary. It's going to, besides putting two businesses out of business, it's going to burden the county for more than what we need. A lot of our business is be here in 2 hours. It's going to fix and start for it. And I noticed one thing with this that I didn't have notes about. The first sentence on here says, as deemed necessary. And that is a very big key in what happens here and what they have. I appreciate your time.
Thank you, sir.
Also, question, David. I mean, weather is always a great concern with a tent, because if you know that there's high winds coming, I know I've rented them, that you will wait till the last possible minute to put them up in case of bad weather. And I mean, if you're in a situation where you've got to hire an inspector, or you've got to have an inspector come out, I mean, it's going to put the public at a total disadvantage.
I don't think it's possible for the fire department to have an inspector sitting there and me and William calling them and saying, we got to have six tents inspected at six different places in the next 4 hours. It's not possible. Besides that, we don't have our permit. You know, because they didn't know they needed the tent until they called me. I mean, they called, you know, probably a third of our business is right now, you know. And that's why we carry liability. That's why we carry the vinyl and all of our tent parts are conforming to the strictest codes in this country. State of California, you can't get any stricter than that. And I think that's enough without having to wait on somebody to come and inspect and work. I looked on the internet, I found one tent where somebody burned up in Georgia, and it was two homeless people in a two-man tent that somebody set on fire asleep. That ain't nothing nobody knew about that. We let no one cook under our tents, we let nobody have open flames under our tents, that's in the rules and regulations of the rental, and I don't see how one could possibly ever catch on fire without somebody wanting it. You know, so, I mean, it's just totally, all it can do is burden the county and the people that wants to have enjoyable parties at their house and not bother soul, but they can't because they can't get what they need to have. Man with 2 acres can't have a party because it's going to rain and he's playing this party for months, because now he's got to wait on a permit and 2 or 3 days of waiting on an inspection. And, you know, it's just a big burden on a lot of people besides us, you know. So I just think that the as deemed necessary in that line on that needs to really be checked out like it should. I appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Mr. Baker, one question about, as you referenced, if a person put a tent up at their house, that's exempt from it, isn't it?
Yes, sir, that would be exempt.
So, single family, if you wanted to throw up a tent Saturday afternoon for a big party, that's exempt?
Yes, sir. That standard does not apply to one or two family.
Is but there, if they were having an employee party at their business, say it was a furniture store or whatever, they wanted to have an employee party, employee picnic in the back of the store, that's a business. So if they got a tent on the last minute because all of a sudden they thought it was going to rain that evening, that's subject to inspection?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
And are you confident we can inspect them on very short notice?
Are we going to allow online permits?
Yeah, we would certainly invite online electronic permitting.
Can it be established that certain people who are in that business can either self-permit or get a permit granted that's good for a year or something?
No, because they have to come out and inspect
it. Well, I mean, there's a lot of alternatives out there if we're bored. Go ahead, sir.
Hey, let me back up. The statute must say someplace who it is that's qualified to inspect and probably to permit.
know who it designates?
That comes out of the state minimum fire safety standards, sir, and it puts that very either on the state, if it's applicable, or a municipality of 300,000 people.
So, but it doesn't say you guys have to, it doesn't say the permit has to come from you, or the inspection has to come from you, is that correct?
Our interpretation of the code, sir, since it does deal with fire protection, all of the other fire protection ordinances, puts that burden upon the fire department.
You know, like nonprofits, like we, several of us went to the garden party that was held for the Historical Society. That was held at a private business at Advanced Disposal. So they, the nonprofit, would have been required to have gotten, if this rule was in effect, they would have had to have been out additional dollars for a permit and had to have been inspected, because it was a big tent.
Yes, ma'am. And to clarify, number one, this rule is in effect, it is currently state law. And if they had done that in any other jurisdiction, they would have had to have a permit for it. When we were hand-delivering the letters to the tent vendors, one of them said something that was kind of interesting. They had applied to get a tent permit, and they found it odd they didn't have to get a tent permit, but they did have to get a permit to hang a 4x8 banner up. So this is nothing new.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
It's something that we just haven't, we're inspecting the tents now. We're inspecting the tents now. The permitting process simply allows us to make sure that they know what the standards are, and it makes sure that we get to see all of them that are put up that fall under the guidelines.
But I guess the question goes back to Ken. We just need to really know, can we leave out parts that we're not comfortable with?
That's right. I mean, I think that's the question that I've heard from a couple of members.
But if we're not coming, I'd like to be assured that if we are coming, if it does pass, is there some way to have an online permit, quick, easy, they don't have to come
yes,
in?
Yes,
permit?
We discussed online permitting and also faxing the permits in. It's a very simple page and a half, maybe two pages. Nothing very complicated.
And have something, if it's a time, if you don't show up in 2 hours, he's okay.
That's what police is for.
I mean, if we had to, can we put rules like that on Kim?
Good. The only concern I'm having with respect to the online component of this is if we are charging a fee, the fee anticipates a service. And so to the extent that we are wanting someone just to pay a fee, there has to be an inspection. That's my point. I mean, it just can't be.
Well, I thought we have to put, can we have to put a time limit on the inspection?
That's right. Well, I think that's correct. We have to do that.
Chief, most fire inspections now are done by the marshal. Fire marshal, correct? Under you?
Yes.
How many personnel do you have under you?
We currently have 5 inspectors.
Are they working on Saturdays and Sundays when those things are based on place?
Some of them are, yes, sir.
And do you feel that you could, if somebody permitted something on Friday afternoon, that's all the weather cleared, that you could have somebody there, let's say there's 3 of them that come at the same time, at 9, 10, 11 the next morning?
Yes, sir.
And it wouldn't be a burden on your department?
We're already doing it for certain occupancies, fireworks displays, after hours permit, or after hours inspections for business owners. We're doing it now. It's more work for us, but we can do it.
When there's a fire in the community that you may deem arson, who does that investigation?
We do.
And if you had one of those that was fairly large and it took up a chunk of your personnel, would you still be able to handle those inspections?
We have dedicated investigators, sir, that don't do inspections.
Thank you.
We have a few minutes left in my house. Like to come on, Mr. Sessions. Leave enough time for your co-workers to get back.
In my opinion, this right here is the only flame resistant, and it's pouring rain, middle of the night. It's a whole lot more cost feasible for this county and everybody else. And not have to call these inspections. Sometimes I know William has, and I have too. We put up tents at midnight. I put up one for the Disney store at midnight in Dawsonville because they were having a tractor trailer load of inventory coming in the back of the building, and they had to have that tent up from midnight till the next morning when they opened. I'm just saying, when you got the strictest codes in the state, in the country, back in your tent, back in your bio on all your tents, and you've got I've got every one of my guys that puts up tents or certified to put tents up. I've got the flame resistance codes for the state of California, and it's totally just overdone, in my opinion.
If we have to enact this, Mr. Sexton, would you like to see the online permit and a 2 hour limit, no matter what time it is, to have a tent inspected?
Well, that's just going to be, you know, for somebody, a $500 event, it's going to cost them 20% more, 20% more. And that's a lot of money for any, the way people are now and the economic times we're in, that could make the difference in somebody having some. I mean, a lot of people has 50, 60 person graduation party, and they don't plan for a tent for the last minute. And they're not going to like it when you tell them, well, I can do your tent stuff for $100, for $500, but you're going to have to pay a $100 inspection fee because our county decides we need to be able to.
But if they're the house, it doesn't, you know, if you have a graduate, if it's that part at their house, it doesn't apply.
No, but it could be at their daddy's business. You know what I'm saying? That's right. It could be if you had one for your kids, I know your kids are grown, but if you have one, if your kid decide to have it at the business because you have more room inside, then you're under a permit, and all of a sudden it's fixing to rain, and you ain't got enough room for the caterers and everybody, but you got to wait on the permit and to get something inspected that passes the code of the strictest fire marshal in the country. It is that's what don't.
Well, and we all know, if we're being realistic, that it's just a matter of time till you're going to need more employees to have to enforce this. And you're going to come back in a year and ask for more inspectors. And I mean, just the benefit package alone is $35,000-$40,000 that the taxpayers are paying for that. And I mean, it's just no win. Yeah, well, I mean, if we're providing a lot of public safety, and we've had a lot of people get hurt.
Let's let the gentleman speak, and then we can have some comments.
Basically, between me and William, we're going to need an inspector on call 24 hours a day.
Give him some time to speak.
I'm William Flynn, owner of Tents. My question is, I've got a few questions. Who would be held responsible for the people that want to test the system and don't want to do the permitting deal? Would the tent company be held responsible, or would the end customer?
Could you please ask that again? I didn't understand all of it.
I wanted to know who's going to be held responsible for not getting this done. Me as an owner of a company that's putting the tent up, or the customer in which I work for that is telling me to put the tent up?
The burden for the permit would fall upon the tent company.
And so that means the tent company would be held responsible and fined?
Our goal is not to fine. Our goal is to ensure compliance. But the tent company is providing the tent. Part of the requirements are to make sure that the tent meets certain standards. That burden is on the tent company.
Also, a lot of people will rent a tent and put walls on it, or don't put walls on it. Is there a difference with a tent in someone's personal business that has no walls?
Yes, that's the 700 square foot rule. If it's less than 700 square feet and has no sides, it's exempt.
Okay. I put up an average of 10 to 15 tents per week. The majority of them here in Forsyth County. And you're saying you would be able to come and inspect all of those tents in an adequate amount of time. And if they are on the weekends, is that going to be an additional fee that the customer is going to have to entail because you're charging it an after-hours fee or any of those type of fees to go along with it?
There would be no additional fees, no after-hours fees. Are all of those tents being put up at businesses? Again, if they're going on personal property.
The majority.
Okay. If they're on personal property, they wouldn't need inspecting.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with the personal property. I have a problem with the businesses.
Yes, we would be able to take care of that for you.
I believe that's it.
Thank you, sir.
Well, any other comments from the public? Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
I move.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. At this time, any other questions from the commissioners on this matter? Counsel?
Mr. Chairman, I think I understand my instructions.
Okay. Chief, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
There's no action required, since we will have a second public hearing on this. Thank y'all. Item three, second reading of proposed amendments to Forsyth County Pond Ropers and Pond Shop Establishments, ordinance number 96, for purpose to modify the regulation governing pond roper and pond shop establishments related to knives and firearms. County Attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. This public hearing pertains to the Forsyth County Pond Roper and Pond Shop Ordinance 96. This actually was, this actually was the product of the fairly significant rewrite we did some months ago, and in the course of that, you may recall, we received some public feedback, that there was a concern that our ordinance sort of glanced too far into the realm of regulating firearms, and as you know, the regulation of firearms counties are pretty much preempted totally by state law. So whether or not we believe that we are regulating firearms, which I candidly did not, there's some things we've done in other jurisdictions just to sort of nail that down. And so you'll see in section 96, item 2, in the proposed modification, we've added two paragraphs. One, we say that firearms shall not be regulated pursuant to this article. Again, sometimes the easiest way to say something is just to say it. It's not the intention for Forsyth County to regulate firearms by way of the pawn shop ordinance. So we're saying that. Then in E2, we say the same things with respect to knives. And even though we're not attempting to regulate either firearms or knives, they are still subject to the reporting requirements, the pawn shop ordinance, the transaction requirements, and all the things that we are attempting to accomplish by way of our pawn shop ordinance. And then we added, on section 96.15, we struck some language pertaining to knives, switchblade knives, dirks, swords, and canes, etc. So again, this is the second public hearing, Mr. Chairman. This is what I would consider to be some housekeeping just to address some constituents' concerns. The board may adopt at the close of the public hearing.
Thank you, sir. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Is anyone here this evening like to speak in favor? Anyone here like to speak with any comments on the pawn shop? Related to guns and knives? Any comments at all? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. As the council stated, this is our second public hearing. We'll enable to vote on this ordinance. Do I hear a motion?
Let me give you just a moment, Chairman. Counselor, this is something you feel is necessary to clean this up so we're not conflicting with state law.
It will at least take away any argument that we are attempting to regulate firearms. I will concede the point. We cannot do this. This at least puts this to bed for the fourth round.
Make a motion to adopt resolution ordinance amending Forsyth County ordinance number 96, the Forsyth County Pawn Brokers and Pawn Shop Establishment Ordinance, as shown in our books and described by council.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to clear up the pawn shop broker law. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Thank you, council. Item 4 is a request by Brentwood Estates Homeowner Association to amend zoning conditions placed on ZA2774 GBSI AZ130021.
This is case number AZ130021, amendment of zoning conditions in Commission District 2. This is a public hearing for Brentwood Estates Homeowners Association regarding the deletion of zoning condition number 20, which was placed on ZA2774. Condition 20, which the applicant would like to delete, reads as follows on the screen. This property is located on the west side of Old Atlanta Road in Brentwood Estates subdivision and was zoned R2R by the Board of Commissioners on July 28, 2003. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Chair, entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. Motion and second to open. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Is anyone here not speaking in favor of the zoning application? Yes, sir. Please come forward. And over here to Mitch Gruen there, associate county manager.
Good evening, commissioners. Thank you for your time and your service. First, I wanted to address, my name's Todd Lenz, I'm on behalf of both states. We recently met with some individuals at the board of Long Lane subdivision to address any concerns that they may have had regarding the removal of the buffer. The initial concern was obviously the draining of runoff rainwater. We addressed that issue with the fact that if any grading or if the buffer was removed, any grading that would come from that by a property owner in Brentwood's case would only increase the water flow back towards their property and not towards Long Lake subdivision. After we met with them, I was told that they would be meeting with their constituents, their subdivision, the following evening, and they would discuss it at that time. Upon speaking with their president, they have decided that they are going to fight the entire removal of it, even though we have proposed reducing or making any type of modifications from taking the buffer from a non-disturbable buffer to a disturbable or something that could be landscaped or modified. Their initial concern, were the property values, the precedents, were the next two concerns that they brought up. Property values. Per the current county property tax codes and website, the DIS, current properties of Brentwood Estates are valued significantly more than those at Long Lake. So having a negative impact on Long Lake is just not feasible. Precedents. We wanted to not allow it to be removed because of precedents with their other neighboring communities and commercial properties. I can understand that about the commercial properties. However, with the residential properties, they are not at complete build out as of yet, which I can also understand. We don't want an eyesore if the developer goes under and cannot finish their development. Our development, though small, is completely built out and finished completely. In closing, in spite of addressing the Long Lake concerns, they've taken a negative position and decided they wish to keep it as is. The buffer was valid in 2003. I agree. Okay, if I would have lived in Long Lake, I would have wanted that buffer, not knowing what was going to come of the property there. There are a lot of rundown properties that are currently, you know, not being built or kept. Today, that's no longer valid. We are a completely established community 10 years later. Currently with the buffer, that takes up 30 to 50% of our backyards that we cannot touch. We can't go in and regrade it so that we can establish proper drainage away from our homes. In cases on my side, which is the south side of Brentwood Estates. We can't even go in and address safety issues. Removing barbed wire, fencing, and also removing poison ivy, poison oak, and other items like that some homeowners are actually allergic to. Simply put, the residents want to be able to utilize their backyards like those of Long Lake, where we can clean it up, we can landscape it, put a fence up. Next, Long Lake really has no financial interest in the buffer. It does not impact their property whatsoever. Lastly, we're a small neighborhood. I hope that the consideration will be made based on common sense and not on how many signatures we can obtain. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else like to speak in favor?
Thank you, Commissioners, for hearing this today, for your time. I live at 2730 Brentwood Estates, and I'm here also for comments on this.
Just state your name, please.
I'm sorry, Kristen Huff. Why it is that we're asking for what we're asking for. First of all, I may be falling on the deck here, but these are photos I took of my property today, which I can't remember if you want to look at them. This is my backyard. The arrows where there's orange arrows point to trees that were planted before we closed on our house, before we even looked at the lot. All of this area back here, and my neighbor who's here attested this, was covered in cuts. Against what this says, okay, I cleared out that cutscene because not doing so would have killed all of those trees, okay, that already existed along that fence line. Those of us who have lived, okay, anywhere in the South for any length of time can attest to the three articles that will support what kudzu does when it takes over trees, takes over any native plants, okay, it destroys it, chokes it out, kills it. Finally, I will not force these on anyone, but these are pictures of my kids and my puppy, 9 weeks old puppy, okay? Okay, I'm not gonna force this on anyone. My point, okay, in bringing these is to say that, you know, we are a small community of families. We have kids, we have dogs, we have pets that we want to keep secure. We want them to be able to play in our backyards the way my residents get to do and our surrounding residents get to do. We're not asking for unreasonable, the ridiculous. We're asking to be able to fence in our entire backyard, landscape it, improve it. Okay, that can only help not only our community and its resellability, but those around our community. Thank you very much.
Anyone else like to speak in favor? We have about 3 minutes left. We'll go to opposition. Anyone like to speak in opposition to this?
Hello, Chris Butler, Long Lake, President of Long Lake HOA. I believe I preempted the discussion, came up here a little bit earlier. Printed my paper a little early, but I'll review my comments real briefly for you before I heard them. But I represent Long Lake. Long Lake is a neighborhood in South Shad County that represents 542 homes, 542 taxpayers and residents and voters. And this buffer was put in. We knew about it when we moved into our neighborhood. It was part of the reason we bought into our neighborhood. We believe buffers serve a good purpose of providing visual breakups between neighborhoods, noise boundaries, and making sure water isn't running the wrong direction. Right now, I understand individuals can apply for variance. They can come before you and say, hey, I would like to do something in my buffer. I would like to remove some cuts of it, or remove some poison ivy, something like that. They could go get their neighbor behind them in Long Lake to sign off on such and bring it before you and get a special exception. We would much prefer residents do what's set up now rather than have a blanket removal of 35-foot buffers. When a resident has a 35-foot buffer, that's part of their property value. When they sell their house, they say, hey, nobody can do anything within 35 feet of my property boundary. To take that away, you depress the property value. That's why we, the board, couldn't suggest relaxing that, because we would be liable for such. We're not going to get in the business of removing buffers and interpreting them as well. We'd like to stick with the individual freedom of somebody to apply for variance. You guys look at it and decide. Our residents don't want basketball courts, they don't want lights, they don't want swimming pools coming on the property boundary. Right now, they don't have to worry about that. They don't want to have to start worrying about that. Making a blanket removal of 35-foot buffer, and then they leave all control and don't know what they can put back there. They'd rather look at it on a one-off basis. We also believe it's bad precedent. It's there now. We start deteriorating these buffers. It's going to become that, you know, so for other neighbors to request our buffers to be relaxed, and that's going to depress our values even further. The property that we're talking about is a downhill slope, and we have a lake at the end of that slope. Removal of vegetation will create silt. Silt will flow directly into our lake. We know where else we're to go. We don't want to take any chances of putting additional silt in our lake. We've already dealt with that in prior developments. And when it was first put in, we don't have to do it again. It costs about $100,000 to dredge our lake. We don't have to do that anymore. So, our research does that we got 222 petitions completed in a couple of days. It's not a very popular idea in our neighborhood. Our residents are very against this. Thank you for your time.
Thanks, sir. Anyone else like speaking on petition?
Yes, sir.
Please come forward.
My name is John Davis. I live in Sharon Springs subdivision. It's adjacent to Merkle Estates. We're a smaller community. I actually own about 2.5 acres. It's adjacent to the property. And I've got a couple of pictures that I brought. That's a good one. I wish you can see where they've already encroached the buffer. They've already cleaned it out. That's a considerable amount more than just taking out cut zero and poison ivy. They've actually run the trees up about 8 or 10 feet and cleaned out, completely killed all the undergrowth. And you can see on the bottom picture, a lot of trees are taken out where the buffer's gone. I saw code enforcement, I'm sorry, you can actually see on the top picture, that's what it looked like. There's a few houses in there that have not touched the buffer, and that's what that is the picture of that. I called code enforcement. They came out, and I think there were some citations in regards to disturbance of the buffer. So it's pretty much what we're here today, I think. That's happening. Basically, just trying to remove the buffer. We got 2.5 acres on a vacant lot that I would love to sell and build on in the future. Let's say, just like Longwood, we have a private backyard now, and it's wide open. Build houses in Forsyth County, I'm dealing with non-disturbance buffers all the time. And based on believe that if you approve this, it's setting precedence for other people in the county who have undisturbed buffers and who actually apply with them and who don't encroach on them. So I think we're on a slippery slope if we do actually start going through them and allowing people to remove these buffers. There are a lot of people I know of in this county. So again, I'm just saying opposition. I appreciate your time. Thank you so much.
Thanks, sir. Anyone else like to speak in opposition? Have any comments of any kind on this from the audience? Yes, sir. We just put you in opposition side. Okay. I got 5 minutes.
That's fine. I'm a resident of Merkle Estates, and my feeling is that Long Lake and other subdivisions have no skin in the game. They're asking for something that actually belongs to us. We paid the taxes on it, and we're just asking to use it the same way they use their backyards. It's not a real difficult situation. We would just like to say courtesies with regard to basketball hoops. I happen to have one in my back, not my backyard, but my neighbor behind the backyard. Those kids are out all hours of the day during summer, which is fine because they're not playing Xbox. I mean, it's a good thing. But basketball room is already there. It's not in our subdivision. We have codes against the basketball rooms. So my point is that all we're asking for is to be able to do what they can do in their backyards. It's our property, it's our purchase, it's our taxes.
Mr. Chairman, I didn't hear the speaker give his name.
I thought he did.
No. My name is Tom Farrell, and I'm in front of the States.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Any other comments? I hear a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Close the public hearing. Commissioner District 2, Commissioner Towns.
As I stated before, Mr. Chairman, we have a public hearing on the decision to be the 19th of September.
Second.
Have a motion and second to move the decision on September 19th. Please vote. Motion carries five to zero. Item five, request by 14905 Hopewell Group LLC to amend zoning conditions placed on ZA2457 All Waters Incorporated, AZ130016.
Mr. Chairman, case number AZ130016 is an amendment of zoning conditions located in District Number 3.
Excuse me, Nancy, I don't believe that your microphone is on.
Sorry, thank you. Case number AC130016, amendment of zoning conditions located in District Number 3. This is a public hearing for 14905 Hopewell Group LLC regarding the amendment of zoning conditions and the proposed zoning conditions to be amended as shown on the screen. This property is located on the east side of Bethelview Road at the end of Bennett Parkway and was zoned CDD and R3 with a PUD overlay by the Board of Commissioners on November 13th in the year 2000. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Is anyone here to tap in my speaking in favor?
Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Commissioners, I can relate to here on behalf of 14905 Hopewell Group LLC in this request for a change of zoning condition. This property is located on Bethelview Road and it is served by Bennett Parkway, which was originally built or constructed as an industrial park with a very wide road. I think it's 30 or 32 feet wide. That was the idea for it when it was originally built. Subsequently, it was changed to a mixed use of residential and commercial. And the residential has been pretty well built out, and the commercial has not been built. And what our proposal is to convert the commercial spaces there that would be built, which could total up to 282,000 square feet with 300 parking spaces, to not exceed 61 single family homes. That's what we're proposing, single family homes, 61 of them. Now, approximately 16 of these would back up to property which is currently being used for commercial warehouse space there on Bethelview Road. And for those lots, they'll be detached single family homes. No townhomes will be provided on this property. They'll be detached single family homes. And then the remainder of the homes, which is about 45, would also be detached single family homes. The amount of traffic generated by the homes versus what would be generated if 282,000 square feet commercial space with 300 parking spaces were built, it is greatly less for what we are proposing. It is much less as one-fourth or one-fifth, if depending on what the commercial would be, but it would not be less than 50%, a 50% decrease in the amount of traffic. We'll be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Justice. Would anyone else like to speak in favor? will not speak in opposition. Yes, ma'am. I mean, we have to speak in opposition, just two. Okay. Yeah. 15 minutes, please.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, my name is Joan Russett. I'm on the Board of Directors for the Bethel Downs Homeowners Association. Last week, we had a general neighborhood meeting with Commissioner Levesque and Attorney Lipscomb. A lot of our concerns were brought up at that time, and I am now going to list our concerns for this amendment. First of all, it's water resources. We want the development to meet fire flows of 750 to 1500 GPM, whichever is greater, approved by the Forsyth County Fire Department. I don't know if you know, but we had a tremendous fire in our subdivision that within a half hour burnt completely down four homes. So that is a major concern. We request the City of Cumming to determine if there is adequate water for these homes. Currently, our Bethel Downs subdivision was required to be built with pressure boosters on each water line into the home in order to pass the building code requirement to provide minimum water pressure. Our next concern is traffic input. We request that the developer install a right turn lane on Bennett Parkway exiting onto Bethelview Road upon completion and acceptance of the Bethelview Road widening process. This is to be done at the developer's expense. We have a backup of traffic at the present time, and we feel if this could be widened, it would help eliminate traffic getting onto Bethelview Road in the light. Next is the environmental impact. We would need to have a certified engineering study done by a firm other than the developer before and after construction to determine impact and risk on our lakes once the developer has flattened the land. We request a five-year, $250,000 bond. When construction was completed by Pulte, our community experienced problems for 2 years with runoff into our lakes. A settlement was reached with Pulte Corporation, and an engineer redesigned and resized these retention ponds to accommodate the runoff. The cost of this was $200,000 to have these dredged, and that was back in 2005. That's where we're coming up with the $250,000. We would require the homes in Pod A shall be not less than 2,000 square feet of heated floor space, exclusive of garages, basements, and porches. These homes shall have a density of 3 per acre. These homes shall have a frontage of minimum 20 feet with a minimum of 10 feet in between structures. Structures in Pod B, which the developer shows as townhouses, shall become single-family homes with a minimum of 1,800 square feet heated and have a buffer zone of a minimum 50 feet as per the original zone application ZA-2457, stating, starting from existing First Citizen Bank exit road to their new proposed road. There is no reason to knock all those trees down, because where he's proposing to put the road, there is, I believe, space to leave some of those trees up. He's saying these houses would face the back of a used car dealer and for Citizens Bank. So in order to sell them, I think it would be to his advantage to keep some of these trees up. Townhouses are not accepted, attached or unattached. Fronts of all dwellings shall consist of brick, stone, shingles, or synthetic stucco. Exterior building material shall not consist of aluminum or lighting, vinyl siding, which I understand now is a requirement of Forsyth County. Mr. Bennett stated at our meeting that he would sell the lots for $50,000 each. We request that these be sold to a builder for the complete number of lots to be built on, not piece by piece. We required the developer to install sidewalks on the east side of Bennett Parkway and along one side of any road he constructs. Also, we would like to know who is the developer and who is the engineer. According to the Secretary of State's office, Contracting Engineers Incorporated is not a legally registered company in the state of Georgia. Apparently, Contracting Engineers Inc., which is a change, it's INC and not incorporated, just became a registered company today, September 5. And this is according to the Secretary of State, who has emailed us this information. The names are different. The name on our site block is Contracting Engineers Incorporated, which is not registered with the state. In closing, I have copies of petitions, which I have asked that all of you receive a copy of, and the clerk has them, with at least 150 signatures of residents from our subdivision who are opposed to the application that was presented to you. We do not want commercial property, but we want some of the amendments made to the original amendment to the zone. So we request that you defer your decision on this amendment until all of these concerns have been addressed. Now, we have met just yesterday with Commissioner Levent. He is trying to work with us, but we need answers before you can make your decision. Thank you for your time, and I would appreciate it if the clerk would pass out signed petitions you have for you. Thank you,
ma'am.
Developer and the HOA there get together and work out an examination of, from a certified reliable company, the condition of the lake prior to any development taking place, prior to any wind disturbance taking place there, so that everyone will know what the silt measurements or whatever they would test for when before the land disturbance starts. And then if the residents there, the HOA, notice that they think there's been some change, that can be measured to determine if that is the case. Certainly adequate water pressure will be required before the project can go forward. So those fire flow and other tests will have to be made, else the project could not go forward. I think that's all.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Anyone else like to speak in favor? Opposition?
Like I say, we are not against a residential neighborhood there. But what they came in originally was going to value our homes. So, and we just need, we know the road is wide. We need maybe, I think, 10 feet more to make it two lanes exiting so that it'll help the flow in the morning when people are trying to get to the 400. Thank you.
Thank you. If I may, just to clarify that, they're referring to right at the end of Meadow Parkway where it meets Bethany, not the entire length of the road. Mr. Lipscomb may have thought they were being looking about 150 feet of the right turn lane, basically.
Is this time for comment?
No, sir. But this one?
Yeah.
Opposition, I guess.
Yes.
Okay. We have some time left.
There actually was 2 minutes left.
Okay. Now, are you public comments or
what? Sorry, right? Yeah.
He lives.
I'm with
okay.
You. Okay. Well, I'll be brief.
Yes, sir. It's fine. Yeah.
In the spirit.
Yeah, like 2 minutes.
First, I want to thank you for coming to our meeting the other night. That was very helpful.
But
the thing I want to say is,
state your name.
Or Joe Smith. The entity that's trying to accomplish this change, it ought to be a zoning change, by the way. It's not a name. But that entity is not licensed in the state of Georgia to create the drawings that this decision is based on. That makes it illegal. They're not. We got confirmation from the Secretary of State of Georgia that they're not licensed in Georgia. So I don't know how you can be considering their desire to change this stuff when it's based on documents that are submitted without legal. So I guess that's the question I have. The Secretary of State says they're not licensed in Georgia, as well as, give me just a second. The Board of Registration for Professional Engineers also says the same thing. So it seems to me like you ought to just be saying that you got to start over and do it a different way because we can't base it on the documents that are legal. So I think that's extremely important. And I don't know which of these folks here is the person who chases down legal matters, but you really ought to check that out. So please. Our neighborhood doesn't want this, and it's not right. There's so many problems with it, including water pressure. But please, stop this. Start it over, and let's do it right and see where it goes.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, would point out to you that the applicant is 14905 Hopewell Group, LLC. And I don't think there's any contention that they're not a validly existing corporation here in the state of Georgia. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just You got a minute left, sir.
Okay, yeah.
Come back to the podium.
I'm not arguing with...
I'm
not arguing with their legal entity. I'm arguing with the fact that the documents they're using as engineering documents were prepared by an entity that is not legal. So, you know, I'm not disputing what he said. I'm saying the evidence they're giving to accomplish what they're trying to do is inappropriate because it's based on, I don't want to say fraudulent documents, but inappropriate documents. I asked the owner of this property at our meeting with him, I asked him if it turns out that the people who prepared those documents that we had out in front of us are not licensed in the state of Georgia, would you withdraw your request? You were there. His answer was, yes. If it turns out they're not legal, I will withdraw my request. According to the state of Georgia, they're not legal. He said in the meeting that you were at, I withdraw my request if they're not legal, even if he didn't want to withdraw his request. You guys ought to just stop this because it's not legal. Not this, but the evidence they're using to try to accomplish this.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Chairman, just if I might address.
Let's get, okay, opposition's out of time. Do we have any left over? Let's get opposition.
Just a clarification, Mr. Chairman. UDC does not require engineered documents for a site plan. The site plan is not an engineered document. It does not require that. It is it's a concept plan, and that's the basis by which it was submitted. And whether a company is incorporated or Inc. it makes no difference whether the company is incorporated or Inc. It wouldn't make any difference if there was no seal or no stamp on the document. It is a conceptual site plan, not an engineered draw, and your UDC provides that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Any other comments in favor? I believe the opposition is out of time. Is your comment for or against? Yes, sir. Yes. Can we give them a minute? Without exception, without 1 minute.
That'll have to apply to both sides, of course.
Yes, sir. Emory has some more time, but we have 1 minute to both sides.
My name is Paul Dodger. I live in the subdivision, Avenue subdivision. I am a fellow professional, gentleman engineer. And I have exception to the way he represented himself at this meeting that we all attended, and Commissioner Levin was there too. It is to mislead, which in my opinion is a major breach of public trust. He, as Mr. Lipscomb was saying, under the regulations, it's not required for this to be an engineering document. But the matter of fact is, it was an actually signed document, not signed, but placed under his company logo to imply that it was an engineering document. When he was confronted with the question that, is this true or not? Are you an engineer? What is your relationship with the company that's proposing that. That's what I thought.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Lipscomb, you know, do you have any rebuttal? Sir, any other statements, Mr. Lipscomb?
Yes, sir.
Again, there is no representation in what we have submitted that these are engineered drawings, engineered plans. They're specifically denied to be engineered drawings or plans. The engineered plans will come if and when this is approved and when it's submitted for approval by the county, and when the county has approved, those will be engineered plans, and they'll have to be gone. They'll have to be abided by, and they'll be sealed by an engineer. But what has been submitted to you is a concept plan. It's not submitted as an engineered plan. none of the plans which are submitted for the zoning application or amendment to a zoning condition are engineered plans. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lister. Do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion to second to close. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Any questions from the board?
This is to planning. What res would a 5,000 square foot lot occur under, or if this was just going to be zoned as a res 2 or 3 or 4 or 5? It's a res 6 size lot.
4 or 6,000.
And
that's what it was.
I guess I need to be a little unclear. This is a change because this was a PUD. Is that correct? Why it's not being a rezoning?
Amendment to the PUD is my understanding.
Started out as a PUD, so it actually has a... Well, the current zoning of the other stuff is Res 3, but now we're going to be using 5,000 square foot lots according to this...
That's the old Res 3, which is like a Res 6 today.
Yeah, and 3,040 square foot lots on Pod B.
That's why they're recommending changes, and I've helped them come up with some of those. But I will agree with you that Pod B is smaller than the rest of the neighborhood, but we've so far with these amendments to the point that the rest of Pod A, which is a majority of it, is the same, is exactly the same as what they have now and what was zoned as the pods back when.
5,000.
Yeah, and back then, this 5,000 square foot homes also had a minimum of 1,400 square foot for homes, although they ended up bigger than that. That's why they come forward with the 2,000 square foot minimum that they'd like to see. And in Pod B, they would like to see at least 1,800 minimum, other than the 14 that they had on theirs, with the same distance between homes as they're existing today. I think Mr. Goff, that they'd probably like to see it left alone, but considering this commercial possibly coming someday, that I believe the majority, the best I could tell, the emails I received, the majority, the mass majority, what it looks like now, including the HOA coming forward, would prefer to see residential the same as what theirs is, with a similar look, if not greater than what they have. And I believe we're up to at this moment.
So as it relates to this, what I think I heard even the opposition say is that the density that's being suggested here is okay.
Three, not being as expensive.
You want a bunch of, there's a lot of other things, but okay. All right, that's all I just wanted to
clear.
Not fire flow. Chief, we should have sufficient fire flow. I bet you go down there.
It's in the city of Columbia.
It's not how the water is.
Mr. Chairman, it's a city of Columbia line, and I prefer that with Tim.
Yeah.
But my experience, it is sufficient along with Bethany, yes, sir.
I have been sufficient pressure on him.
We have talked to the city this week, and they are checking into that. They feed that from the backside. That our line's out on Bethany, and we go down to the transcontinental gas line. But there is a connection there that the city has with us that they can supplement water into the subdivision. I believe it's been turned off. They're turning it back on. It's got a pressure sustaining valve. And so there is a way for them to supplement the water supply. And I know they're looking into the pressure situation. But I'll accept possibly this smaller Pod B that might be on our side of the service line. But the residential parts have to be across the gas line to be the city's.
Well, we do have a state minimum water pressure pump that we have to supply.
Mr. Chairman, also, in defense of our water departments, the fire that happened previously that is referred to a number of times, I was there that day on duty, and it was significant, but the issues weren't related to a lack of water volume. Just like that noted.
Thank you. Commissioner, District 3, Commissioner Levin, do you have, you ready to make a decision?
I'd like to make a statement, probably a motion to postpone it. Being that both sides here have made comments that they have additional items they'd like to hammer out and work out within the conditions. Therefore, after listening to all these comments, the public comments, I'm aware of several other issues have been raised regarding this proposal, zoning condition amendment. I'm also aware that all potential zoning conditions have not yet been hammered out. Therefore, based upon UDC 8-5.5 F2, UDC 8.9.4 B and 3 and A, I move that this decision on ZA 130016 be postponed for 2 weeks to September 19th. And that during this 2 week period, the application be returned to the Department of Planning and Community Development for further review and as we work through these conditions.
Have a motion. I hear a second.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any other discussion?
Mr. Chairman, just a clarification. I think there was a transposition. Commissioner Levin, it was AZ130016. That's just, I know that's what you meant.
Yeah, of course it is. But I said it.
Said the original one.
Sorry.
This is decision only. Oh.
This is decision only. The public hearing is closed. Yes.
We have a motion and a second. Please vote. That carries 5. Item 6 has been postponed to October 3rd. Item 7 has been postponed to October 3rd. Item 8, request by John Lowen for a variance to the Unified Development Code, Table 11.2B, to allow lots 1 through 9, 13 through 15, 41 through 44, 46, 47, 52, 53. And in Gates, Casper subdivision, they have front yard setbacks of 20 feet.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. Case number VA 130048, John Lloyd, in Commission District 1. This is a public hearing for John Lloyd regarding the variance to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code, Table 11.2B, to allow lots 1 through 9, 13 through 15, 41 through 44, 46, 47, 52, and 53 in the Gates at Castleberry subdivision to have front yard setbacks of 20 feet. The Gates at Castleberry subdivision is located on Castleberry Road and is currently zoned Res 3. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. Have a motion second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Who not speaking in favor on this variance?
Good evening. My name is John Lloyd. I represent Fisher Development Company, who is the owner of approximately 44 lots there in Gates of Castleberry. The project was previously developed in 2006 and platted in 2007. Four homes were built at the time, and the project went into foreclosure with the previous developer. Fisher Development Company has purchased, like I said, the majority of lots in the neighborhood, and we are in the process of regrading the lots that they've been built on. There are state waters and county industry buffers and impervious setbacks and slopes that limit the product for sale to some of the smaller homes in their product line. And our intent is to request the front setback variance so that we can put additional product in there, as well as keep the product a little bit closer to the road and further away from these undisturbed buffers and these substantial slopes. I brought a site plan. If you haven't seen it, I can show you the lots that we're looking at and where the slopes are. Thank you very much. I look forward to answering your questions tonight.
Thank you. Anyone else like to speak in favor? Anyone like to speak in opposition? Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Domenico Scloco. I am a homeowner. I'm a homeowner at Gates Castleberry, and I'm here representing five homeowners, including myself. And we oppose VA 130048. Our reasons are that current homes, including three that were built by the developer who requested this change, are set back 30 feet. I believe would change the visual appeal of the neighborhood and the value of all of the homes that are there now. For these reasons, I hope the requested change will not be allowed. Thank you.
Anyone else like to speak in opposition? Or would like to have some rebuttal? That or?
Sure. I appreciate his comments. We feel that the way that the lots were previously platted and the way the streets have been installed previously are an unfortunate situation brought on by some, probably some hasty planning, I guess, initially. We would like to have the opportunity to move the houses that far forward as needed. The reason we picked the 20 feet as our final number was so that you can still park a car in the driveway, not blocking any sidewalks or anything, so we're selling sidewalks on both sides of the street. So we have thought through, I guess, the compromises and, you know, for in the front setbacks, and we feel that was the appropriate size. Thank you.
And did your company build any of the five homes in this subdivision?
So not the five that they're speaking of. The Fisher Homes is the builder who was going to be building on those lots. They have built a model as well as a single house currently, and they have another house under construction. I guess a total of two houses under construction, a model home, and just opened. So they just opened.
But some lots will meet the setback. Just certain lots will not meet the setback, correct?
We've requested a variance on the lot, the majority of the lot, all of the lots that they own. And this project is split between Forsyth County and the city. So we have requested a variance for all of those lots so that we didn't have a lot of staggering that I understand I'm talking about, you know, rather than just a few lots on the buffer. I'd be happy to show you, I guess.
Has the variance been granted by the city county?
We have not applied yet.
Would you consider from the 30 feet, not going to 20 to 25, or would that not work?
I would, obviously, the further we can get away from the creek and the heavy slopes, the better we are. We find ourselves in a situation that they have a lot of product that they can sell out there. Some of the narrower product, or I guess what you would call it, smaller in depth, is obviously a smaller footprint house, so they would like to have the ability to sell on as many of those lots as possible the larger product. So I know that the current UDC under Res 3 is 25 feet, although, and that's why we requested the 20.
Is there a sidewalk on the same side of the road as what you're looking to get your variance?
I'm sorry?
Sidewalks.
So there will be sidewalks on both sides of the street.
When you have a home too close to the street and people park in their driveway, it forces people to walk in the street instead of on the sidewalk.
Yes.
And that's some of the reasons why those minimum standards are there. That's what you understand that.
Yes. Yes. And our thought, you know, a normal parking spot in a commercial parking lot is 9 feet by 18 feet. So we felt that 20 in the sidewalk is going to sit, you know, 7 feet behind the back of curb. So then in theory, it could give you a total of 25 feet probably from the garage door to where the sidewalk is likely going to be.
So how many lots are going to be in the city county?
I believe it's 30 lots total. I can tell you specifically.
You haven't applied for the variance there yet?
No, sir, we haven't. The way that the site was left by the previous developers required a lot of additional grading. So that's been our focus up until now. We will be applying to the city of Cumming as soon as we get a little bit closer on the grade. Okay. And to answer your question, 25 lots in the city.
Any other questions from the board? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moves.
Sorry, can I have a rebuttal on that, please?
Yes, sir, I'm sorry. I'll take back that. Second. The motion. Thank you, sir.
I'll take back the motion.
Come on, okay. Sir.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just want to speak
wait
about...
Wait to get to the speaker, please.
I just want to talk about, he mentioned, you know, the parking in front of the house. Right. Now what's going to happen is if we wind up moving these houses closer, yeah, everybody's talking, yeah, you can park one car there. But we all know there's going to be visitors in the neighborhood. So what's going to happen at overflow? It's going to go on the street. All right? And you're going to have more congestion. Right? I mean, I've got two kids, right? And yes, we want to keep them on our property when they're playing, but you never know what they're going to be doing. All right? So that buffer there is going to be reduced. All right? And I just wanted to mention that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now, do I hear a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
Have a motion to second to close. Please vote. Vote for carry. Mission District 1. I'd like to make a motion that we postpone this to September 19th. Well, one of the major reasons, I'd like to talk to City Cummins and get their opinion. I hate for us to grant a variance and they won't. So I'd like to talk to City Cummins see what their idea about this variance is and talk some more to Mr. DeVille. Motion, have a second?
Yes.
Motion, second, please vote.
Thank you.
Delayed to September 19th. Old business, we do not have any. On the new business, number one, the acceptance of the Tyler Technologies municipal contract for financial software.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. This is for acceptance of the actual agreement with Tyler Technology, and this is for the financial software that the board previously approved under RFP 1274-1500 at the May 21st work session, and then later ratified under the consent agenda on the regular meeting on June 6th. Again, this is the agreement that has gone through legal, and the company as well has agreed to this. And we're just asking for acceptance. Thank you.
Thank you. What's the pleasure of the board on this item?
Make a motion for the acceptance of the Tyler Technologies Munis contract for the financial software as presented.
Second.
Have a motion and a second for the acceptance of the contract. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. New business number two, board review and consideration of possible approval of the comprehensive revisions to Forsyth County enabling legislation pursuant to the county's home rule power. And attorney.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you very much. I do have a short presentation on this. This is a fairly significant sort of update. Most of it's housekeeping with respect to our enabling legislation. In the vernacular of the municipality, this would be the functional equivalent of our charter. It is the document that establishes the county and establishes our sort of our bottom level of the pyramid, our all of the authority with which we have to take action. So, the Georgia Constitution provides that we can change our own enabling legislation. That is a component of what's called home rule. There's specific ways you have to do it, and the way we have to do it is we have to basically run a legal synopsis of the proposed modifications to our enabling legislation. They've been running now for 3 consecutive weeks. They must be run for 3 consecutive weeks prior to the final date that you take action. It also requires you to approve these modifications twice. So actually, at the end of this presentation today, I'm going to be asking you to adopt a resolution. The resolution is in your agenda book. That will not have the effect of amending your enabling legislation. In fact, it won't be until the September 19th meeting, the second amendment or the second approval of the resolution, that your enabling legislation will actually be amended, or at least it will be subject to me then sending it to the Georgia Secretary of State, and upon the Secretary of State receipt of it, that's when it becomes effective, and then it'll be actually put into the Georgia Code. So it's a big deal, and it's a really interesting thing that the Georgia counties are able to do. So let me walk you through very quickly what, in fact, we're doing this evening. We are considering amendments to sections 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 11, 12, 12.1, 13, 14, 15, 16, 18, 19, 21, 23, and 25. You all have heard all of this at prior work sessions. That's, of course, where I got the authority to do it. Let me just very quickly go. The first one is sort of a synopsis. I'm going to skip through these, and certainly I will not bore you with reading my synopsis. I'm not going to do that to you. But this is the synopsis of actually all of the changes. But I'm going to go through very quickly a red line so you see exactly what we're contemplating doing. first. Here we go. Section 3, again, I said a lot of this was housekeeping. The first thing we're doing is changing what has been traditionally called our county administrator. We don't have a county administrator anymore. We've got a county manager, so we want to update that. That's in Section 3. We also deleted a language requiring a $3,000 bond. Our bonding requirements are established elsewhere in general law, and of course we get our bonds primarily from our blanket bond from ACCG. Section 5, under bonds, we simply added some language that the cost of the bonds that are required for our public officials are paid by the county. Going on to our oath, you have traditionally been called the commissioners of roads and revenues. You may not know this, but you do a lot more than that now, so it's more than just roads and revenues. So we have deleted the roads and revenues. That was a very traditional old way of referring to boards of commissioners. Section 7, pertaining to salary. Some years ago, the General Assembly adopted 36-524 that allows you all to establish your own salary. You remember how we have to do that? We have to do it prior to qualifying for an election, and you have to get through an election cycle before it becomes effective. We simply made Section 7 of the Home Rule language match what, in fact, general law allows now. Regular meetings, we deleted some awkward language that dealt with when a regular meeting or a special meeting could be called. It said that it could be called by the chairman or by the other four members of the board. Candidly, I didn't know what that meant. That four of you had to get together, which would have been an open meetings act violation anyway, to call a meeting. So we struck that and just indicated that you can call a meeting pursuant to the internal rules that you all adopt every year. The clerk, actually Section 11 set the clerk's annual salary at $4,200 per year. That was a touch low in 2013, so we thought we might want to modify Section 11 pertaining to the clerk of the county such that you could set those by way of your purchasing policy, excuse me, your personnel policies and your payroll policies. Your powers generally, you can see we struck language that basically gave you power over the superintendent of public schools. I'm sure you understand why that's self-evident. You don't need the power over the superintendent of schools. We also added some language in the bottom of the paragraph pertaining to basically recognition that we have now our own personnel policies and we are in fact a civil service jurisdiction. That's in Section 11 pertaining to your powers. Under your police powers, we actually, the language that is in there with respect to the adoption of ordinances was not terribly compelling. It allowed these things called readings. You didn't even have to have a public hearing before we adopted ordinances. We have, in fact, modified this to make it consistent with our more exacting requirements of two back-to-back public hearings and also otherwise made it consistent with the code pertaining to county ordinances at 36.1. With respect to records and audits, I think Mr. Brewer will attest that we are regulated quite stringently by the state with respect to our audit requirements, with respect to our financials, and we simply made that consistent with the audit requirements by the state. Section 15 actually sort of terrifyingly referred to as crimes, but it says that it should be unlawful for any candidate for or member of the Board of Commissioners to enter into an agreement or understanding with the person as to the disposal of any work, the purchase of any supplies, etc. And what we did was basically harmonize that to make it consistent with state law and otherwise consistent with our ethics code. Section 16, with respect to contracts, we also harmonize that to make it consistent with our ethics code. You can see, I hope you can see on the right, what was deleted. Financial statements, once again, we tried to make Section 18 pertaining to financial statements consistent with the state of the general law. Understand that even if our local laws were on the books, to the extent there was general law, when I say general law, I mean a statute in the state of Georgia that conflicted with our local law, the general law is going to be controlling. So some of these changes are nothing other than a recognition that the General Assembly has addressed these issues in a general law context. Section 19, Mr. Chairman, this pertains to you. You are otherwise required to have some fairly consistent office hours, and although we appreciate once you're in the office, we thought it might be more reasonable that the office hours you had to provide were simply what your schedule will accommodate.
that you didn't have to be in there a certain amount of time each week. Section 21 actually pertains to the county doing business with entities in Georgia that no longer exist. We updated that to make sure that we were dealing with the Georgia Department of Transportation and the Federal Highway Administration. And 23, the provisions of this act shall become effective in accordance with the governing law. As I mentioned to you, you have to adopt this evening. You have to adopt it then on September 19th. Then I have to bundle it all up and send it to the Georgia Secretary of State. Mr. Chairman, that's my presentation. This isn't a public hearing. This is simply a recitation of what we're proposing to change, discussion of the procedure, and if the Board of Commissioners has any questions to me, please ask them. If not, all I would ask of you, if you are so inclined, would be to adopt the resolution that is set forth in your agenda packet. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you, Council. That's a nice recitation.
The first one is mostly just form where it says in swearing in, it makes a distinction between the chairman and commissioners. You have section six pertaining to the oath?
Right. I just want to make sure that doesn't mean that you do it all at once. If one of us is missing, or the chairman's missing, we can't proceed with this. Because it says chairman and commissioner.
You know, it's actually interesting. That's not what we change, but practically speaking, I don't even think that at the time of swearing in, well, that typically does happen in December, which is true, so it might technically be a chairman, but technically a new member would not be a chairman at that point, if you understand the point I'm making.
Right.
I think there's nothing, I don't think there's anything technical about that language. I think it's just trying to accomplish, and it may be Commissioner Boff, candidly, and I would have to go back and research back into the early days of the enabling legislation. There may have been a time when we elected chairman. I just don't remember if we did that.
Okay, and then my other question, Dave, actually, this may include you, about the local accounting and stuff. Does the CAFR need to be mentioned? Does the talk seem to say local accounting? Purchasing and financing and audit procedures.
I've got that up there, Mr. Gordon, 13. Are you talking about section 13, Commissioner Ball?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And candidly, while Mr. Gordon was getting his bearings, you know, we kept that language perfect, you know, very broad because with all of the requirements that keep getting added with respect to how we have to provide all these things. I thought, and I hope Mr. Gerd will agree, that probably broad language was better.
Yes, Commissioner, you're referring to the end of that statement where it talks about locally adopted. We do have locally adopted, board adopted financial policies and procedures that we do follow.
Okay, but I thought mostly is the thing called the CAFR.
Okay. That's probably kept. There was another section on audits, if I recall correctly, and that addressed the audit being prepared each year. That's where you see the CAFRs includes the audit.
That's section 18.
I would think by reference there would be included there.
As long as you're happy with it.
Yes, we reviewed it, and I think it includes all of that.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Do we have a motion for the board?
Chairman, I make the motion that we adopt for the resolution and the changes as presented to us by Council. And the resolution is the resolution by the Board of Commissioners modifying the local act, creating the Board of Commissioners, and providing for certain requirements and authorizations related thereto.
Thank you. Second.
Got a motion and second for approval. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 3. The adoption of resolution clarifying action taken at the August 15, 2013 Board of Commissioners regular meeting. And I at this time will recuse myself from any vote or discussion of this item because my sister-in-law was involved in this land purchase and turned that meeting over to Vice Chairman Mr. Roth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor, do we need to? I think we all know what this is, and I think my best guess is everybody's in agreement. It was kind of a flub, I think, that I made.
That was mine. It was mine.
In the way I worded something. hope it hasn't caused a delay for anybody, so with that, unless somebody wants discussion, I would make a motion that we adopt a resolution of the Board of Commissioners clarifying action taken at the August 15, 2013 regular meeting related to CA 3630.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote. That passes 4-0.
Thank you, John.
Commission Amos. Back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. Administrative hearings. Item one.
Which item?
Administrative hearings. Our first one is the Noble Business Group, LLC, doing business as Cumming Food Mart. This is in Commission District 4. This is an administrative hearing regarding the appeal of the suspension of an alcohol server permit for S.N. Usman from a citation of underage sales at Noble Business Group, LLC, doing business as Cumming Food Mart, located at 3275 Delonica Highway. The alcohol server permit